this is John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and a special guest commentator in the garden, actually. So today I'm taking the day off. I'm going to be the camera person, and what we're doing here in my backyard garden, Wendi fam from Wendyland YouTube channel came. I'll put a link down to her channel in the description below. Be sure to check it out. I made a video at her place many years ago where I showed up at her place and like, hey, Wendi, I'm making a tour. And she's like, really? And we did it. Anyways, it's a great video. So anyway, she came out. She's been helping the last yesterday and today. Helped me out in the garden. Actually, we worked on like the Egyptian walking onion. So thanks for your help to get those that whole bed flipped and turned over and get new soil in there and help me clean up. And it's just always so much to do in the garden. So it's always good to have gardening friends. Anyways, I'm like, Wendi, I'm going to do a tour video. Can you hold my camera and film the tour video? Because I do most of the things by myself. And she's like, yeah. And then I was like thinking to myself, I'm like, well, why don't I hold the camera and let Wendi do the video and she'll give a tour of my backyard? So we'll see what she says about my backyard. I have no idea what she's going to say. And I'm just looking forward to it. I'm just holding the camera and shutting my trap. So any comments, Wendi, for you want to share with everybody?
Yeah, I'm excited to give my opinions and maybe some things that won't offend you so much.
No, just say what, I'm serious. Say whatever you want. I won't be offended. And I mean, everybody has a different gardening style and that's it, right? Wendi is kind of more a landscape, pretty garden. Like if you, when I visited her place, oh my God, it's like amazing. It looks like, looks so cool. Mine's like more production style garden to grow more food so I can eat as much out of my garden as I can. And we all have different, you know, goals, and that's all right. You know, your garden doesn't have to look like mine. It doesn't have to look like Wendi's. It's going to be look like yours. I mean, literally, when I'm working my garden, when I'm placing things, planting things, that's like me doing artwork. You know, I get to plant my green bok choy next to my purple bok choy and have them like intermixed. So it's like, it looks really pretty cool. I tried to plant lots of purple stuff, purple plants, you know, vegetables this winter season. And oh, before I forget, you guys are going to be saying, like I know you guys are going to be saying this, John, you and Wendi make such a nice couple. You guys should get together because you're two garden YouTubers. Trust me, Wendy's already taken, number one, right? And I'm not going to say anything else, but she's taken, she's dating a guy here in Las Vegas, so unnamed person. And so that's why she's out visiting, and he's at work, actually. And so, yeah, so she's taken, and I currently have a love interest, and wish me luck with that, and that's all I'm going to have to say about that. So we're not getting together, we're not a couple. Wendi's a great person, and we're doing our own things, all right? So anyways, let's head into the garden and get Wendi to give you a tour.
Okay, going into growing your greens. So right over here, oh no. So super, super delicate sugar snap peas. This is the purple variety that John is growing. They're looking really nice. I think some flowers are probably gonna be coming out pretty soon. And he's got some carrots in there. It's probably some red carrots, I bet. I bet you they're like red anthocyanin. And pansies, edible flowers. So important, I think. It's just not just so pretty in the garden, but I love growing a lot of edible flowers too because they're really good in dishes and pictures and, you know, beneficial insects and just high in antioxidants. So it's really cool to see that he's growing them, especially the really black colored ones. Got a yellow dot in there. So yeah, sometimes, I mean, people take these vitamins or lutein, I think is what it's called, for your eyes, and instead you can just always be eating the yellow stuff here, which I think, oh, he's got some in the back that way. Right over here, this is a perennial bed full of tree collards. So many different kinds, and it's really cool because I like growing a lot of perennials because they're available, you know, year-round. Especially if you have annuals that might mess up or something, doesn't grow out so well, you always have these food as backup. Then right over here, you got this new bed planted. This is purple broccoli, I believe. It's got some bok choy. I'm just like, let's see. Yep, they're looking good. I think probably they should be, oh, this one's bolting. This is so pretty though. I mean, even if the stuff bolts, okay, you can still, you know, eat them and eat the leaves. It's not just for the flowers, even though you're growing broccoli. That's really cool. And then right here next to it, it's got this raised bed with some different kind of kales mixed there and some radicchio. which is, let's see which one. Let me show you guys. Oh, right here. So I was asking John earlier, I said, which one's ridiculous? Because I'm used to seeing like the endives and things at the market that they grow. It's more like a small like romaine heart or something. But this is the open leaf variety apparently. And I'm actually really curious what it tastes like. Let's see. Thank you. Actually, it'd be really nice as a wrap. It's just like thin, but it's still kind of firm. It's not so delicate when it fall apart. I think this would make a really nice like roll. Yeah, it's good flavor. It's not as bitter as the other kinds. Cool. Let's see here. Oh my goodness. So here's the forest of tree collards. You guys want to take a guess how tall this is? I think this is like probably like two of me. Two Wendy's. Okay, so I'm just gonna measure this thing. We're guessing this is like 10 feet. Oh, I think I'm supposed to start from the bottom. The air feels nicer up here. Close, right? It is pushing 9 feet actually. 114 inches. So that's 9 feet 6 inches. Wow. It's almost two of me. Almost. Need to get a little taller than that. Okay. Wow. So you can see if you're growing perennials like these, you'll never, ever, ever run out of food. And they're actually sweeter. They're sweeter in the winter, which I think a lot of cabbages are. So. Mm. Oh, wow. Actually, yeah. Okay, that's good. All right, let's come on down. This is a new vegetable that I learned on this trip. This is called a bugleweed. It grows really well in full sun, but also John's got some other ones, a couple ones growing in the shade, like full shade, and they're growing really well. And they're just so pretty. Just super, like, so purple that it looks black. And pansies. So pretty, different purples. And then right next to that, you got the orange color, which are good for your eyes. Thank you. Hey, is there any, and carrots. These some carrots. This is sort of like garden treats, right? Oh, and then these ones are edible too. And I think these one brings in like butterflies, I think. I have these growing too. And these one actually really likes to be in full sun, I noticed. Wow, look at that. This is like the sun's energy you can see like radiating out. So, so pretty. And, actually, the heart of the pansy, it kind of has like that wintergreen, like minty flavor. Like, yeah, like that gum. It's really good. Super faint, but it's like you can taste it the more you chew it up. And then carrots. Carrot greens I just ate, because you can also eat the greens. I'm sure that's actually why John grows it. Eat the roots and eat the leaves before you harvest the root. And then we're getting closer to the Asian vegetable section that I'm excited about. This plant actually originally came from me at one point. This is the grass jelly. I've done a video showing how to do that, and I'll have to ask John if he's tried making some jelly on that yet. It's growing quite nicely and it's actually being protected right next to the genera longevity spinach. And it's got some like bigger kind of light bulbs hung so it keeps them warmer at night. Got the burlap thing actually makes a huge difference because I think the temperature, the coolest, it's dropped down to like 29 degrees here. And these things are super good. And
And John was saying that it actually looks better than it did before he had them covered. So they kind of roll up and get some sun in the morning, and then they come back down at night and get some nice use of space. He's got all these vertical, you know, these kales here growing vertically, and they're just super beautiful. Some peppers are still around. Really nice. Oh, and right behind me, we got these kumquats. Look how long this kumquat is. These things, the skin is sweet. The juice is super flavorful, so good as a juice. Like, instead of making like lemonade and stuff, you can make with this stuff, and it makes like a really good sauce too. Even for salad dressings, you can mix this in. It has really good bright citrus flavor, but it's like, it's just really unique. It's not like an orange or lemon. It's just kind of like a cross between different kinds of citrus, and they're just really good and whatever you want to put them in. Right over this bed, it's got Ashitaba growing. And these things actually grow really well in the winter. Notice in Vegas, even for me in SoCal and in zone 9 and zone 10, they grow so well in the winter. I've read that they will go dormant in the winter, but haven't seen that happening even in Northern California. And these things actually taste better in the winter too. They're a little sweeter. Let's see. Yeah, it's got quite a few growing here, and they just kind of keep coming up like a bunch of little new growths. And these like super bright colored sap that they produce are super good for you. And this stuff really stained, like. Some tastes like resin. All right, let's see. Okay, let's get on there and see some more newly planted stuff. Wow. So these ones, this is Jerusalem artichoke, also called sunchokes. I was surprised to see them here because mine were already dying off. Like, they flowered and they died off, and they're kind of more sensitive to the cold. But I guess this one's being kind of like shaded over. I mean, it's protected, getting some heat from this plant, and also this tree collar is just protecting, keeping them a little warmer. So I'm guessing that's why they're growing really well here. They're just like nice use of space in the pot too. Right over here, got one of my favorite plants of all time. This is the root beer plant, sarsaparilla. This thing seriously smells like root beer. I'm not kidding you. Gosh. You guys should try like juicing this. And then like maybe with some cane juice, maybe sparkling water. Like, what is that called? Mineral water? That's probably kind of like, tastes like root beer. Oh, and the buckwheat. Yeah, that's what I wanted to show you. Right in here. It's getting like 100% shade. I mean, it's not even shade. It's like growing in darkness. And it's actually, so it's not producing that black color, but the plant is not really stretching. It's just, they're fine. Like, they seem so hardy. And a lot of rosemary. These rosemary actually have like, wow, the essential oils on this thing is crazy. Like, it also just rained yesterday, so super strong. More tree collards. Guess what John's favorite green is? More broccoli. This is a different variety of broccoli, apparently, and it actually looked like, I thought it was like a radish of some kind, but it's a different variety, and it's called a Sassatina grossa. I'm actually very curious what this broccoli is going to look like. I'm a make sure you let me know so I come around and eat them, John. Oh my god, so you've got this huge mound of oregano. Gosh, I forget this as well. Get the name of this one. It's more like a Middle Eastern or something. It's just super, super strong. And I think you can make essential oils with this kind of super spicy. And you can even boil some water and like breathe it in. You have respiratory problems or sinus. It definitely would take that away in the instant. It's just super, super spicy and potent. Lavender. This is such an herb, but it's just it smells so good. Have you guys ever tried juicing with some lavender buds? They're really good. I like them with like mulberries and different kinds of berries. It's just like that little hint of that lavender is really good. Let's see. Crazy amounts of mint. Never ending. I'm glad that he's, well, it's taken over this whole raised bed, but it is nice to have a very dedicated space for them because they really just go wild and almost can't ever get rid of them. Wow, look at this bed here. This is very, very nicely landscaped. I guess this is more of my style. And John's a very particular kind of a guy with his garden, but I can understand why. I mean, this is actually, he's growing food for himself and he's got all this stuff going on. So everything is just like so, you know, methodical and like thought out and placed in just right. And this one here, I really like that there is a tree collar in the center. It just displays really nicely. And he's got like repeating deep purple vegetables and the greens. It just makes them really like pop. The only thing is, I think you should get full sun here, right? Like I would probably even add in some bright yellow, orange pansies or violas or something. Says something about the yellow warm tones just pops when you put them right next to the deep purples and black colored leaves. So yeah, I would probably plant some flowers in between. It's just so pretty. Right here. Okay. I want to say these are beets, right? Okay, so these are beets, and actually the beet leaves are edible. They're actually quite sweet too if you juice them or make smoothies with them. So it's nice that when you can eat the greens and, you know, before the time of harvest that you can get the beets to eat. And let's see, beets are definitely one of the ones I really enjoy growing in the winter. Well, in zone 10 winter. And I like that he was, you know, using really just good use of space growing this Malabar spinach. They are dying off right now, but I can see it's just nice to have it kind of just trail up on the tree, just acting as it's a trellis. And I can see how it just kind of like drapes over in the summer and it's really pretty. This is a Japanese mugwort. This thing grows so well here. It's just, this is a really hardy plant. There's so many different kinds of mugworts, but I think this one has like a more mild tasting to me. So I can actually eat this more like a vegetable. We got some parsley growing here, sorrel. This is a nice salad bed here. Like there's some stuff ready for harvest. Some goodies in the bottom. Oh my gosh. Look at this. So this is all the beautiful purple bok choy. He's got it kind of, you know, alternating again, the green and the purple, and then the center piece here just displayed so beautifully. Super pretty. I also like growing a lot of purple stuff, not just that because it's pretty, but they're really good for you. They're, you know, like protect you from cancer and just anti-aging, you know, just all these immune boosting. It's just all these good benefits for growing purple, red stuff. And also in traditional Chinese medicine, the dark color stuff are actually good for your heart. Yeah. Oh. Thank you. Let's go. Oh, wow. So here we have the sunchokes, as I was showing you guys earlier. That one that was growing in the pot underneath the tree collar is being protected from the cold. So that one's growing so lush, like it's springtime or something. And then this one here, these ones are drying out, dying off, leaves are turning yellow because it's fully exposed to the air. And right behind it's got a goji berry, which actually goes dormant in the winter. But it's actually one of the really, you know, healthy little berries that you can grow really easily, and they take heat really well. Let's see here. More kale, more broccoli, lots of broccoli. So these are the praying mantis eggs where they hatch from. So these ones are already hatched. They'll hatch when it warms up. So we actually found some fresh eggs that has not been hatched that's in the garden, so I'll show you that in a bit. And they're really just, they eat up all the bat insects, I guess you call them. Look at this raised bed. The Matsua, super pretty. This is just really decorative. One of my favorites. So beautiful. Do I need to say even more? It's got some beautiful Asian vegetables and some broccoli in here. Some actually bolting. This one here. You can see that a lot of these greens, I mean, greens in the winter is what, you know, grows best. Most time in the summer you want to save like growing fruits and tomatoes and peppers and things more like fruity stuff, I guess. But in the winter is a really good time to grow herbs. It's good to grow greens because I think we also need more nutrition, like more nutrient dense food in the winter because it's cold and you lack the sun, and it's just really great that you're able to grow, you know, greens to cover that part of your health. And it's just it doesn't take up that much space and it just grows so fast. So it was really cool to see that John has all kinds of like varieties of greens. Let's get over here. So this was our 2-day project. We pulled out some dried stuff, and this is like the walking onions here, and some clumping chives. And we basically pulled them out and took out, you know, the little baby bulbs and planted them. Topped the bed off and put in the irrigation back on. And we actually found a couple of new praying mantis eggs here. I'm not sure what, here they are. It's right here. So you can tell it's not like, they'll kind of be like in layers when they open, but right now it's fully sealed. But that's the new one. Right there. So in the spring when it gets warm enough, a bunch of little babies will come out. Army. Garden army. Obstacles are always fun. Kind of gives you a little more workout, working out different parts of your muscles that you're not used to if you're just kind of walking on, I guess, flat land and open space. But over here, he's got these, probably grows wild here now. These are stinging nettles. I really enjoy them. I know John eats them raw, but they're actually really tasty cooked too, or if I dry them as tea. They taste like really good green tea. So you just want to be careful when you harvest these things because they are kind of called stingy nettle for a reason. And I find that the more older the leaves are, the more mature, the more tougher, like the needles are actually harder. And especially if they get more sun, they get really like, they're just really stingy. Like when I catch them, I think I'll feel the pain for a few days sometimes. So anyway, so these ones looks like they're mainly on the bottom I'm seeing. So the way to eat this is to just fold it up. You're basically hiding as much of that stingy thing as much as possible. Fold it like a present. And then, it's good flavor. It's good, it helps with allergies too, which is really good for, especially I think in spring, a lot of these would pop out, especially in places that freezes over. When the springtime, they kind of sprout up, and that's actually a good time because all the pollen comes in and you can eat this to kind of just boost your immune system and get you not sneezing. Figs are actually one of the easier fruit trees to grow, especially here in Las Vegas. In the desert, they take the heat really well, but right now you're seeing that a lot of them has dropped, but there's a few figs up there still. Wonder if they're gonna ripen correctly. But yeah, it is normal to see them, the leaves fall off in the winter, but I'm seeing these little new buds here they're gonna put out once it warms up. And they don't take very much room. They can just be in like a 15-gallon pot and you can still get some figs growing. It's like there's different varieties here. And right over here, got more purple bok choy with this beautiful centerpiece here. Wow. Loving the purple. Some more broccolis. Oh, and this is a lemongrass. Actually, these are really good, like, if you add a little bit of these to, like, in the juice to a flavor, they're really tasty. Let's see. Right over here, this is probably one of my favorite beds. Or maybe that one too, but it's just, I love all the details, just the way all these sorts of vegetables grow and like throw lettuce, and I can totally see this in like a display somewhere, you know, like an amusement park or somewhere trying to like educate children how to grow their own food or something. This is just so nice. And right behind, look at all these romaine. These lettuce are so gorgeous. They're growing so well. And got more sugar snaps. And then right below it, as I was saying earlier about being careful about where you place your mint, because they would go crazy. But in this case, I think it's a really good use of space. You got these little cracks. You can stick them in there and they'll grow right out. And it's just so pretty to see them kind of, you know, maybe drape down. And yeah, I mean, you probably can plant mint and purslane in here. That's probably the only things I could really think of. Look at these really deep colors. Lettuce, usually, yeah, this is a good time of the year to grow them. I mean, they're more of a cool season crop. Even in Asia, they would actually grow lettuce in more higher altitudes, like by the mountain area where it's cooler. Look at all these cilantro. Oh my God, they're so beautiful. Cilantro is also one of the ones I enjoy growing in the winter. And I think for some of you guys might be in maybe early springtime. It's a cool weather crop still. It's they'll bolt once it gets warm. So this is really a great time to be planting some cilantro, also called coriander, which I actually enjoy when it starts to bolt. The buds, you can actually make a tea, or I actually juice it. And when there's buds on there, they start, you know, when you use like the coriander seeds, it has that sort of like sweet floral flavor. I really enjoy that. Maybe with like some, like juicing that with like carrots, carrots and apples or something. They smell different than the leaves. Oh, and then the seeds. Yeah, you can always save the seeds and put in like a peppercorn grinder. Looks like he's got a kohlrabi here. Kohlrabi, and that looks a little high up there, but they would get really big. They almost look like alien plants to me. And the leaves are edible. The heart of it is actually really tasty too. It has a really interesting, like, crunchy, firm kind of a texture. This is a Tokyo Bacana. It looks like lettuce, but it's actually in the mustard family. It's so pretty. It's got this golden yellow color that I really like, that he's actually paired it up with this, you know, bright color, glowing color next to this super deep purple kale. Super, super beautiful. Finally, this bed here. Again, John's got a lot of tree collards growing. I mean, if you grow one collard tree, you get many, many branches that you can easily cut to propagate. And then right below, this is all the other plants. Got some carrots here, some deep red colored Swiss chard, some onions. And I think this is a pretty good mix for a salad here, just in this raised bed. What do you think about the tour, John?
I thought that was a great tour, but the question is, what do you guys think out there? Do you guys like my tours better, or Wendy's tours? Wendy's more delicate, probably easier on the eyes than I am, and I'm more harsh, and kind of tell you like everything of this and this and this, and she just kind of like give you a good general overview of my garden, and it's kind of fun for me to hear some of her, you know, comments about it. Like, I really like how she was able to see how I'm actually trying to plant things out to make it look pretty. Like, I really kind of, it's like, to me, this is like my palette. Like, if people paint, I don't paint. But I like literally could plant things in certain areas to make it look really cool. You know, I choose some locations to plant things because I know in a certain location that plant will do better than another. So like, normally I'd plant lettuce in beds, and one problem is I didn't have enough lettuce starts to plant in my beds over on this side like I normally would. So I plant them in the best bed I have, which is that long bed, which gets the most sun, the fabric pot bed. And they're just growing amazing, and they're just doing so well. And I have so many brassica family plants, like purple broccoli, purple cauliflower, like five different kinds of broccoli. She pointed out one of the special kinds, and like all different kinds of like basically greens. I mean, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, and I want you guys to grow and eat your greens no matter where you live in the country. This time of year, you guys can be growing greens. You're like, John, it's snowing outside, man. Are you high? And I'm not high, but you guys can be growing your greens because you can grow microgreens inside your house. So be sure to check the videos down below. We'll have some microgreens videos, and also even outside, you know, you can put up a double hoop house if it's legal for you to do so. I found some people in recently Chicago actually putting up a hoop house in your backyard to grow through the wintertime is illegal. I was like, what? I cannot believe that. I thought that was such a travesty. So the lady interviewed me for her YouTube channel and my opinions on that. Like, that's just so ridiculous.
How would they even know anyway?
Well, they just have people driving by and they could see, oh, you got something over, you know.
Build a higher wall. I'm just kidding.
Yeah, build a higher wall. That's it. Yeah. All right, so any other comments or things you'd like to say, Wendy, about like how I can improve? Because here's the thing, you know, I'm always open to taking suggestions for potential improvements. Because, I mean, I know what I know, and I do things the way I do things, and there's definitely way more ways to do things, and maybe I don't even do all the things the best way, but, you know, once again, I'm trying to do this for production.
For sure.
And, you know, have good soil and eat the best food, basically.
For sure. Yeah, speaking of production, I think, like, I'm not so particular as sometimes I would do in-place composting. So like, say there's some stuff that you might have some leaves dropped in there, I might just put, you know, topsoil just over it because they would decompose there anyway. That probably would save you some time.
Yeah, because we're picking out a lot of just little things, because like, I'm concerned more about like, okay, if there's like bacteria or like, I know some of my plants will have like bug eggs on it.
Okay,
so like spider mite eggs, and we're trying to move that off the site so that they're not there.
Okay.
So yeah, that's why I'm kind of more particular about removing dead materials, because like, on, you know, especially indoor grows, if you guys have indoor grows, you guys know, like, you got to get that stuff out, because that could cause disease further down.
I see. Okay, that's why I think communication is really important. Now I get why you're doing this. Like, John's not just anal about
it. It makes sense. I mean, plus it looks cleaner without it. But the other thing is, I agree. I mean, if I need to mulch more, and I'm still looking for the perfect mulch that I could leave in place, because I don't want to like put mulch on and then drag it off after the season, and then it's gonna, and I don't want to get it mixed in. Like, if I use wood chip mulch, mix that in, it's not gonna be so good, because now I got wood in with the soil, which then could pull nitrogen, and then leaves I want them to break down completely. So I'm thinking like, I'm gonna do coconut or cocoa husk mulch, but that's not even available where I am, because it smells nice as long as your dog doesn't eat it and then it breaks down relatively quickly and adds a fertilizer value to your garden. So come spring, I think I'm gonna be able to source some of that stuff.
Yeah.
But currently, I'm not. You know, I mean, I guess you could also use hay and straw, but you know, I get strong winds here, like 50 miles an hour sometimes, and like I'm afraid.
Pick up right up.
You know, we'll light stuff will blow away. I was at a convention trade show recently, and they had like you know, sterilized rice hulls, which could also be used as mulch, and they use it in nurseries for like topping off containers. I never went out to buy them by the pallet because that's not available near me. But I think that would be pretty cool because it would mat once you water it. And that's kind of what the coconut or the cocoa husks would do. They mat once you get them wet. So they kind of create a barrier. Because, I mean, that's one area where I am totally deficient. So if you guys have any good suggestions on a good mulch that breaks down within a season and I could mix in, that's really not going to like really affect my grow and, you know, not look so unsightly, let me know.
Yeah. Oh, also, I think there's a type... Actually, it's part of like the cacao shells or something. Not the shells, but I don't know, some part of that plant. And they use that as mulch and it smells like chocolate.
That's what it is. That's what I'm talking. Cocoa husks. Cocoa husk mulch may be available. Like if you guys have a Menards, you guys are lucky. Menards has it. Like, you know, in certain parts of the country. I think California Armstrong has it near you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But like here in Vegas, we have shit for like nurseries and they don't sell it, so it's like it's very difficult for me to get, so unless I drive out to LA and bring back bags or, you know, try to get some shipped or something, you know, it's hard for me to find. So I mean, I'm on the lookout. If you find a place with free shipping and I could order a bunch of it, let me know, because I ain't about to pay, you know, it's like $10 a bag and the shipping's 20. No, I
$30 a bag.
Can't be doing that. But yeah, that, and I like because it smells good. But make sure your animals, your dog does not eat it. That can be potentially toxic to them. So I will be testing it with Oakley first. And also sometimes like it may repel certain, you know, creatures as well because of the smell.
Yeah, it would actually, yeah. Yeah, I had it before with Lotus growing my dog, and she didn't really touch the cacao.
It just depends on the dog. Yeah.
True.
Like my dog got raw cacao beans or chocolate bars when I went to Puerto Rico, the chocolate place, and it got into my luggage and took it out and ate half the bar. I'm like, oh my God, my dog ate chocolate. I mean, he was just hyperactive as heck, but he was fine. But like, do not feed your dog chocolate. No. That was an accident. I mean, that was an accident. He should not have eaten that.
Carobs, if you want to feed them chocolate.
Yeah, carob for sure. I definitely agree. Carob's good stuff.
Good stuff. Good for us too.
All right. Any final comments or words of wisdom before the sun goes down, Wendi?
No, that's it. I'm actually looking forward to a nice meal out of your garden.
Oh, that's new to me. All right. I guess we're gonna make a salad or do something here. So I think that's pretty much it for this episode. Hey, if you guys enjoyed this episode with Wendi, Wendi, how does somebody find you and your videos and your amazing channel? Because, man, Wendi, like, if you like long videos, that's my channel. But if you like more detailed videos that are shorter, check her channel out. I mean, I refer to her channel, you know, on a regular basis. Actually, I was figuring out how to cure or, you know, my sweet potatoes, and she had a video on it. I'm like, oh, that doesn't exactly apply to me. So I came up with my own method that I'll probably have already aired or will be coming out soon. But, yeah, so, like... I always like to learn from many others because I don't know everything and neither do any of us. So it's always great. So how does somebody learn about you?
Wendiland.com, WendiLand. I'm sure John will leave the link down below. For my YouTube channel, I'm also on Instagram and Facebook where I post like, you know, updates that you don't get on YouTube because it's just happens so much faster. It's just like daily life, whatever I'm doing and growing and eating. So that's where you will find me.
All right, cool. And then I also recommend if you guys are looking for plant starts, like Wendi sells select plant starts, like she'll make her own Gynera Procombens from cuttings and she'll sell those. I mean, I could do that here, but I don't have time for that stuff. So I'm glad Wendi does that. And she has some really high quality, good plant starts for you guys on her website, wendiland.com, right?
Yep, that's right.
All right, cool. So if you guys enjoy this video with Wendi giving you guys a tour of my garden, want more videos with Wendi or other guest YouTubers giving you guys tours of my garden, give this video a thumbs up. Let me know. Leave some comments down below. Let me know your thoughts about this whole episode. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else so that you can see what is growing here in my desert garden here in the wintertime. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that are coming out every 3 to 4 or every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what I'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure to click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. I think sometimes YouTube unclicks the bell for people. I don't know how that works. And finally, be sure to check out past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge over 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel dedicated to teach you guys all the best ways to grow your own food and more specifically about specific crops. Like I recently had a hemp video about CBD hemp that I filmed up in Colorado that was amazing. And another video I really liked recently was a video on pawpaws, which is basically a tropical fruit that could be just grown in zone like 4 to 9, which is amazing. You guys got to check that video. Maybe I'll put links down below if I remember. All right. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.